My name is Saitali Köknar, architect by education and design teacher, studio tutor by practice. And I want to speculate about how will we design in the following 50 years and trying to get the picture, what's going to happen. So let's start with the graph. I want to study the exponential first. Okay, what does it look like? I mean, maybe most of you know it, but let's draw it. So what we have in the first moment is like a one unit. And the second moment, it becomes two. And in the third moment, it becomes four and goes forward like forever like this. And then what was before? Half of one and half of the half. And if we combine them, it looks like this. So far, so good. This is exponential graph, no? But what happens if we look far away? Let's zoom out. Okay, and I put this on top of it. It looks like this. Some numbers. This is where we are. And then, yeah, human population growth since 10,000 years. So what should, I mean, I don't know if you see what I see here. I see two things. One is there is a corner here in the exponential growth. Some people call it this edge. It's not a corner, it's curvy, but so before the corner, it's flat, horizontal, and after the corner, it's like whoop, going to the sky, like vertical. And we are here with the population. Okay? So, what's going to happen? Can this continue forever? To understand what's going to happen with the population numbers, we have to go back into the past, to the 1970s. There is this wonderful and very famous, infamous research published as Limits of Growth by Donna Meadows and his Meadows and his partners. And they took some variables in the beginning of the 70s, 1972 to be exact. Some of the variables that you can see there, but they run a simulation within a computer model which was called World 3. And then if the variables they thought would continue as business as usual model, it would look like this. And the dates are like between now and 22nd century, you see a collapse in the population. Simplified, this is the ultimate context we are designing in. We are living in a planet, we have limited sources, we use those resources, population grows, resources are less, and then so less that it cannot sustain itself. If we can colonize Mars, then we have two planets full of resources. If we colonize solar system, we have the limited solar system resources. I mean, this is a permanent problem. It will stay with us forever. Climate crisis? What about that? Within this research, Limits of Growth, Dennis Meadows talks, they kind of published every decade updates. They checked the real data and it fits. They checked the real data, everything is predicted. Since 30 years, they are doing this. And then he did this extra research. In the first edition, climate change as a word didn't exist. In the second report, once. In the third report, 28 times. And, you know, it goes like this. And he insists in one of his interviews that climate change is not a problem or cause. It's just a symptom. And if that symptom goes away, there will be another symptom. It's the, if you want to like to call it problem, is, I don't think it's a problem, it's just a situation if you ask me, but the problem is that we live on a limited, we live in a box, we live in this planet, so we have to take this into consideration. Well, you might ask, this is 1970s, maybe there's more recent research. Yeah, there is, but I will come back to it. I decided to change the order of my presentation, and yeah, hopefully this will change. Yeah, I will come back to it. Let's finish the first part first. So if we do as business as usual, meaning there's no new policies, there's no new innovations, no new businesses, probably it will be the famously called J curve. But we need to learn, or we will learn, it's not a prediction, it's either that or that, you know. We will transition to S curve, which is wonderfully called logical growth. And in the natural environment, the birds, the deers, the rabbits, they do that, you know. This exponential tends to go flatten, you know, in relation with the resources, with the carrying capacity of that environment. So, how are we going to design? If we, you know, beyond climate crisis. So maybe now I can go back to this very famous, fantastical, shared socioeconomic pathways designed by climate scientists to communicate within themselves, because there are so many models they're working under the United Nations, within the International Climate Panel of Climate Change. So there are some teams in Australia, UK, USA, so they have to adjust their variables. So if I kink up this variable, what happens? And they, for the communication, they came up with these four major scenarios for us. So this is not science fiction, but this is scientist fiction. You know, it's the real thing. You know, the science fiction cannot go harder than that. So this is, again, business as usual model. So it means some of the traits that we already have in our world, you take one, extrapolate it, kink it up, and then see what happens. Meaning, if we take the inequality and then extrapolate on it, what happens? Will our carbon dioxide emissions will go down or not? So it's a wonderful way of communicating their ideas to the politicians, to the general society. I mean, I cannot go into the details with this, but go check it. They have large texts explaining each one of them. But what I'm interested is, as a designer, designers tend to go, you know, oversimplify. They like to oversimplify things so they can solve problems. But look at the titles. They are the best science fiction next Netflix series, you know? Like Rocky Road, Green Way, you know? This is the way they communicate with us. But let us think, most importantly, this doesn't mean that sustainability is very equal. There is inequality in it as well, but underrepresented. Here, it's overrepresented. So let us think about it together. What would be the design attitude for the inequality happening right now? Gated communities, and you know, like some people go in the walls, they use the best of the resources, and then the rest, you know, they hang on, like the very famous movie Elysium, you know. People go to the space and the other people live in the planet. So this is the, you know, if you extrapolate and that is the, and interestingly, it is easy to mitigate. So some of the, you know, in the simulations, CO2 goes down without new policies, without new inventions, etc. The Rocky Road, what would be the design behavior for that scenario? Walls between nations, like the one between India and Bangladesh. If Bangladesh is flooded, so they run, they cannot go into India. That's the least famous one. There are more famous walls that I want to talk about. What about the taking the highway? That's my childhood, you know, a new tech, science fiction, you know. We can design electronic trees that feeds, you know, they takes the carbon dioxide and turns into something else. This is easier to adapt. And then there are also sustainable solutions. We will go deeper into that in the following slides. So how will we design? It will probably look like this. So if the edge of the exponential, we can calculate it like started somewhere like 1950s, 70s, it's a very new thing. And then if we manage, if every day with this talk, with your new enterprises or your startups in the future, for example, France in last year, they forbid to construct houses out of concrete, that you have to build houses, housing from wood, renewable resources. New policy, simulations change. Every day, a new policy or a new technology or something, some kind of new way of doing things. Maybe not a new technology, but you know, repurposing a technology. Maybe, I mean, we will turn that corner and then go to this flattened version of a logical growth. It will look like the past, probably. That's my, you know, speculation. So it's vernacular, but kinked up, heightened up with technology. Maybe we can call it Vernatech. I don't know. Vernacular, like Adobe, some kind of a astronaut Adobe. And you know what? They were planning to make some Mars colony out of Adobe. And so they invite Adobe experts in Caltech. You know, it's crazy. So Adobe becomes a material for astronauts. That's interesting. So this will be the general pattern. I mean, you can, if you are gonna invent something, look to the vernacular. You can spice it up and make it really, you know, useful forever, maybe. So I can simplify like this. Since the resources is the real problem, which will never go away, even if, I mean, okay, you can say this, you have a big exam, you're so much stressed about it, you pass the exam, and you have nothing to do, and then you have this post-traumatic, you know, stress. You know, you go crazy with it. So the best way to cope up with this problem is to plan something after. So I'm talking about this. Yes, climate crisis is up ahead, and it's going to happen, you know, the collapse will, yeah, in 80 years, at least. If it goes slower, it will be better. If it's so quick, I don't know, it will be a zombie apocalypse, probably without zombies. But if it goes slowly, with every policy, with every invention, it will go, you know, slow, this transition, and it will be bumpy, but it will transit, and then we will be in this, you know, still the problem is there, resources. So we have to be careful about it. First, don't do nothing. Don't use resources. Use what you have. Fix it. If you need three-room apartment, but you have two, don't tear that two-room apartment. Add another one. You know, this will be the, you know, let's do less option. And then, yeah, or you do it in such a way that it lasts. And lastly, improved with new technology, optimized. I mean, you can use it for this, but then with an improved technology, you can use it even more, with more. Like, let's see a little bit more visuals from Columa Museum from Köln that I took a month ago, the picture. So you use the existing in a such a clever way that it just lives on. It's what our grand, you know, fathers used to do it, no, that way. But since 1950, we don't do it this way. No, we just build new things. That's something new. Remember the exponential curve. It's new. We didn't design that way 200 years ago. So we have to adapt. Adaptive reuse is the new black. We will upgrade, we will expand, we will add. Or we can think about growing resources, renewable resources. This is a beautiful example from Peru, Quechua Bridge, I think. It is made out of grass. The green grass, you see, it's the springtime now, but when it's fall, it's, you know, yellow, and then they collect the grass, all the village, and then they weave it into thin strands, and then this thin strand goes bigger and thicker, and then they create this wonderful bridge every year. And they cut the old one, leave it to the river. It's a biomass. You know, other living things will use it. You know, it's a wonderful strategy to, you know, integrate with our new ways of doing things. Yeah, modularity, circularity, you know, it will be very the high things. Or improved technology. This is a research from a doctoral PhD research from a friend Yelda Agin, together with Wassim Jabi. They are printing. I mean, you are hearing 3D printing. All, I mean, that's a new black again. It's a very hype out thing, but printing with soil. And here is your resource. I mean, under your feet, the resource is everywhere, and then it's You know, if you can tear it down, you can do it again. It's, you know, and it's, you see, this is like this astronaut-farmer relationship. You're a farmer, but you're at the same time an astronaut. You see this oxymoronic relationship? The very old thing becomes a very advanced something. It's a wonderful example that yeah, probably there will be more computation. So instantaneously, by rotating our designs in this, you know, models, we can calculate their energy performances. We don't have that program yet. Can you believe? I mean, there are some special ones, but not available in, you know, popularly. Someone should do it, you know, in this room. So takeaway: architecture, you know, form follows function. No, it's a very famous one. Misunderstood saying, taken from Louis Sullivan's poem, but it's very famous. But it shouldn't follow function because functions change, will change for thousands. I mean, if you're going to build for 100 years, it will change. Of course, the thing that you redesign will follow the function of it, but essentially, it shouldn't follow the function. It should just be, you know, universal. So you can do anything with it. This is the second one, quote from very, you know, infamous Mr. Rohe, Ms. van der Rohe, you know, less is more. We will need even less in resources, not in the shape. Well, they are contingent. They go hand in hand. The minimalism will not be, you know, the new black because it's minimalism, but it's because it makes sense. It uses less resources. Of course, if you study Mr. van der Rohe's projects, he used very expensive marbles, and, you know, very rare marbles in his project, but that's not what we're talking about. The third thing is really a little bit tricky. We tend to beautify the objects. In 50, 70 years, after all these hardships we will go through together, hopefully I will see the end of it. The objects will not appear to us as objects. They will appear like a moment in the process. They will not be separated from the rest of the process. They will become like, we will beautify process more than objects. And the ugly will change. The shabby, reused stuff will look fancy. You know, it's already happening in Berlin, for example. You know, all the shabby stuff is the new hub, you know, because it's, you reuse it and it's beautiful. Finally, hot topic, AI technologies. This is how it goes. There's this long winter of AI, 1970s, and then again, it's exponential. And, you know, for Vernatech, for sustainable startups, for sustainable technologies, we are here. It's coming. The new startups concentrating on the sustainable ways of producing new materials, new processes, new design methodologies, it's right around the corner. So ride the tide. Thank you.